They consciously said, we will not have enough. And even Quigley himself doesn't know what to call it. In his books, sometimes he calls it the Rhodes Group. Other places he calls it the Group. And in other places he calls it the Network. It doesn't have a name. Well, I'm going to change that tonight. I'm giving it a name. I call these people the Rhodesians. So from now on, I'll call it the Rhodes Group or the Rhodesians, and you know at least what I mean by that. Now, so it remains invisible for the most part. And the inner circle of this very hard to see group, they call themselves the Society of the Elect. And there again, that phrase is taken directly from Adam Weishaupt. Amazing. Now, originally that was Cecil Rhodes and a brain trust from British banking circles and politics. As I mentioned a moment ago, that center of gravity shifted away after Cecil Rhodes' death to the Rockefeller Group, and now it has centers of very strong influence in such groups as the Bilderberg Group, the Trilateral Commission, and that sort of thing. And it also shows up in some of the financial circles, the financial meetings, the G7 meeting, G6 meetings take place around the world. And the goal has shifted, as I mentioned, away from the center of the British Empire to the New World Order based on the model of collectivism. The secondary rings around this inner Society of the Elect, they call roundtables. That's their name for it. And these exist in the United States, Great Britain, and all of the former British dependencies. This is the outer ring. This is one more ring out. Now, the tertiary rings around the round tables were formed very quickly, and they were called, in Britain and the former the British dependencies, they were called the Royal Institute for International Affairs. Okay? In the United States, they didn't call it that, I guess because they figured Americans didn't care for the word royal. So they didn't use that name. In the United States, they called it the Council on Foreign Relations, or the CFR. And ladies and gentlemen, after 100 years of penetration into the power centers of society in America, the Rhodesians, this network, now is very close to the final achievement of its goal, a total domination of government, society, politics, economics. At least in the Western world. Now I said the Western world on purpose because I wanted to punctuate at least along the way. I don't have time to develop this either, but I want to emphasize that this is not the only evil empire out there. There are in the world today two major branches of collectivists. They both advocate the same thing. They both want world government based on the model of collectivism. They both use the same tactics of penetrating into the power centers of society. Everything from top to bottom regarding their goals is exactly the same. The only thing they differ over is who is going to be the top man. They fight with each other like cats and dogs for dominance to see who will direct the new world over. On the one side, we have the Rhodesians, which we'll continue to talk this evening, but we must not forget that half of the world, at least, is now in the grips of what I call the Leninists. They used to call themselves communists, but they took a lesson from the Rhodesians and got rid of their name. Now there's no communism with Tony, and there isn't by name, but you notice that the people that used to call themselves commissars, they had this word commissar in their hat, they turned the hats around, and on the other side, it now says social democrat. They're the same heads. And for the most part, even though they talk about free markets and trade the commissars that used to run all the industries for this government now run it through their own personal gain, but they still have absolute control over the people. They still advocate collectivism. They still advocate participation in a new world order, world government, all that sort of thing. And I just want to emphasize that there's a lot going on in the world besides the Rhodesians. There's another group out there which are very dangerous, and you wouldn't want to live under that system either. Okay, having said that, I move back to the main track. That's my summary. And now, let's let the conspirators describe it to prove to you, I hope, that I have not distorted anything I said. So we turn first to the pages of Tragedy and Hope. Now, I regret I'm going to have to do some reading here. I don't like to do that. But as I mentioned, this is a necessity. Otherwise, you'd think that I have distorted what these people are saying. Quigley says this. He says, I know of the operation of this network because I have studied it for 20 years. See, there he calls it a network. I've studied it for 20 years and was permitted for 2 years during the 1960s to examine its papers and secret records. I have no aversion to it or to most of its aims, and have for much of my life been close to it and to many of its instruments. In general, my chief difference of opinion is that it wishes to remain unknown. In his other book, The Anglo-American Establishment, this is what he said. The Rhodes scholarship, established by the terms of Cecil Rhodes' seventh will, are known to everyone. What is not so widely known is that Rhodes, in five previous wills, left his fortune to form a secret society, which was to devote itself to the preservation and expansion of the British Empire. And what does not seem to be known to anyone is that this secret society continues to exist to this day. To be sure, it is not a childish thing like the Ku Klux Klan, and it does not have any secret robes, secret hand clasps, or secret passwords. It does not need any of these, since its members know each other intimately. It probably has no oaths of secrecy, nor any formal procedure of initiation. It does, however, exist, and it holds secret meetings. This group is, as I shall show, one of the most important historical facts of the 20th century. Now, one of the original leaders and organizers of this group was William Stead. I mentioned before he wrote a book entitled The Last Will and Testament of Cecil Rhodes, and he was the executor of Cecil Rhodes' estate. So he speaks with authority when he says, Mr. Rhodes was more than the founder of a dynasty. He aspired to be the creator of one of those vast, semi-religious, quasi-political associations, which, like the Society of Jesus, have played so large a part in the history of the world. To be more strictly accurate, he wished to found an order as the instrument of the will of the dynasty. You see, Cecil Rhodes was thinking of something like a chivalric order, something more than just a group. These were to be people with lifelong commitments and loyalties to an ideal, an order, modeled after the Society of Jesus, for all things. Well, of course, Weishaupt was a Jesuit, so we begin to see the connection there, perhaps indirectly. Now, in Cecil Rhodes' handwritten manuscripts that were not published until fairly recently, this is what he wrote. Cecil Rhodes said, I contend that we English are the finest race in the world, and that the more of the world we inhabit, the better it is for the human race. What scheme could we think of to forward this object? I look into history, and I read the story of the Jesuits. I see what they were able to do in a bad cause, and I might say, under bad leaders. In the present day, I became a member of the Masonic Order. I see the wealth and power they possess, the influence they hold, and I think over their ceremonies. And I wonder that a large body of men can devote themselves to what at times appear to be the most ridiculous and absurd rites, without an object and without an end. Like a will-o'-the-wisp, at last it frames itself into a plan. Why should we not form a secret society with but one object, the furtherance of the British Empire and the bringing of the whole uncivilized world under British rule? You get a sense of the passion and the zeal that this man had. Truly a megalomaniac.